And again, this week, there's a lot of words to listen to. Don't get caught up in the length of the scripture, but try to open your eyes of your heart and hear what God may be telling us this morning about the blind man and what it is to see. This is the word of God. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples had asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus. "But this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spit on the ground, made some mud with his saliva, and put it in the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This meant sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they demanded. He replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash, so that I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God. He does not obey the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided. Finally, they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him?" "It was your eyes he opened." And the man replied, "He is a prophet. The Jews still do not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents." "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it now that he can see?" "We know he is our son," the parents answered, "and we know he was born blind, but how he can see now or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He's of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. That was why his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." Second time they summoned the man who had been blind. "Give glory to God," they said. "We know this man is a sinner." He replied, "Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." And then they asked him, What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered, I have told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Then they hurled insults at him and said, "You are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from." The man answered, "Now that is remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly man who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." And to this they replied, "You were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. When he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come to this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are we blind too?" And Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May I add a blessing to all that have ears to hear. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we thank you. We thank you for mud. It's amazing what can come from a little dirt and water. So open our ears, open our hearts, open our minds to your word this morning and help us learn about the miracle of mud. In Jesus' precious name, amen. It was about, 9 years ago. I was a dean at Wesley Forest for junior high kids. I had probably, I don't know how many kids were there that week, but the week that we had was very rainy. In fact, it had poured for the first 3 days. Now, you think about junior high kids all cooped up for 3 days. Yeah. We had fun, but it was a challenge. We had to be creative. We had to do things that were spontaneous because the kids were beginning to get bored, and once they get bored, you lose their you know, attention. So finally, on the fourth day we were there, it quit raining. And when it's rained really hard for several days in a row, what do you get? Mud. This is what we did. Yes, as we come out of the dining hall that day, we come upon a mud puddle, and there was some kids that started running and were sliding through it on their feet. Well, that quickly progressed, as you can see. Now, there's this one young lady that was there that week. It was her first time at camp. She was in eighth grade. She was a very pretty young lady, very very popular in school. She was dealing with a lot of those teenage issues, making decisions and how to fit in. And she was really having difficulty fitting in with the kids at camp. She had come with a group of other, there's two other guys that she had come with, so they kind of hung out together. They were a little older than the other kids that were there, and so she was really struggling, and I could tell that. And so I tried to strike up a conversation with her a couple times during those initial days, but it was very difficult to break through that barrier, that protection that she was carrying around. Well, that fourth day, finally, when the sun broke out and we could go outside, I happened to be walking with her and a couple of other kids, and we were chatting. And one kid started sliding through the mud. Then the next one decided, I'm going face first. Through the mud. Well, guess what happened? One after another after another. And then my youngest son, Jared, got into the mix, and he went flying through the mud on his belly. And that just kicked in everybody else. And I looked at this young lady. And I said, you're going to go play in the mud? She goes, that just wasn't kind of her thing, you know. Eighth grade, that doesn't sound like something that she should be doing. But I said, hey, I tell you what. If you do it, I'll do it. And she looked at me, and she started running. I caught up with her. I got to the mud puddle first. And by the end, we were all mud. You can see from head to toe. It's amazing what a little mud will do. It's amazing what a little mud will do to break down barriers, to open eyes, and to let God work in our lives. That young lady from that time on was a different young lady because she was relaxed. She could have fun, and she was interacting with the other kids. In fact, that day made a big difference in that group, just playing in a little mud. So I thank God for mud. I thank God for mud. Even though I got in trouble, they said, look at that, look at the mess you made. I said, yeah, I know. And today you'll never know that I let them play in the mud down there, would you? We hear a story today about mud. And how that changed this blind man's life. I found an acronym for MUD that came from Emmy Arnold, and I thought it was kind of appropriate this morning. You want to hit up MUD? Yeah, good. M stands for Made by MUD. Hopefully it's going to fly in if you hit the... Yeah, there we go. U, Unified in Christ Jesus. And D, Designed by the Maker. Mud is an interesting mixture, isn't it? In John chapter 9, we read the story where Jesus made some mud. He picked some dirt up into his hands. He spit into that hand and made some mud. He then put the mud on the blind man's eyes. And after that, he told him to go wash. Wash in the pool of Siloam. And if he did all that, he would receive his sight. The man followed Jesus' instructions to the T, to the letter. And he went quickly off to that pool. And for the first time in this man's life, he was able to see. He could physically see the world around him. Now this was an unheard of miracle. We hear in the scripture that this miracle was believed by many to be even a greater miracle than bringing those back to life that had died. Elijah and Elisha had raised from the dead, but this miracle of giving back the sight of a man that had been born blind, that was unheard of, had not been done before. This chapter is also full of many spiritual truths. Of course, this tells of Jesus' healing power, this story of the blind man. There's also Jesus sharing the revelation that he is the light of the world. We hear that repeatedly through the scriptures, don't we? Through the gospels. And then there's the witness of this man's faith, trust, and obedience to do exactly what Jesus had said and received back his sight. You know how I love to use my mind's eye, right? So I ask you to join in with me. Blind man is alongside the road and Jesus is walking by. And Jesus calls to him, says, come here. And the disciples kind of look at him because he's a blind beggar. But Jesus has compassion on him. And he draws closer to the man. I can just see a brief conversation between the two of them. And then gently Jesus bends down and places some of the loose dirt into his hand. And then he spits in that hand. And then he takes his other finger and mixes it. And it becomes mud. Now just look. Just think of the disciples that are there watching. Think of the people that are around him witnessing this. What is Jesus doing, spitting in his hand? And then he takes that mud with his forefinger. And he tells the gentleman to close your eyes. And he places that mud, one on each eye. And he says, go to the pool of Siloam and you'll be healed. You'll be able to see. Now imagine this blind man. He hasn't seen ever in his life, and he makes his way to the pool of Siloam. He's been there before and he knows the way, so he reaches that pool and he washes. And imagine what that man feels like when he opens his eyes and sees. The first time that he could see the trees and the people. And he could see Jesus with his own eyes. Imagine the joy. Imagine what that man felt like. As I went through that scenario in my mind, mud was one of those words that stuck as I read the scripture, you know? I thought, what's going on with this mud that makes such a big difference with this blind man? And then I saw the mud acronym. And I think that we have a good place to start. As I thought about that mud, I begin also to think of questions that Jesus might ask us. Questions like, will you allow yourself to be mud in my hands? Will you allow your life to be mud in my hands so that someone else may experience the light and be able to see? Will you allow your life to be mud in my hands in order that someone else may experience the wholeness so they may experience what it would be to call Jesus Savior and Lord? Mud reminds us that we are all made by the Lord Himself, that miracles happen when we unite with Jesus, and we are co-partners in this design for salvation and healing. Mud reminds us that we are made by the Lord Himself. One of the ingredients of mud is dirt. We're reminded in Genesis that God took dirt from the earth, formed the first man, Adam, and then breathed life into him, spirit into that man. It's Genesis 2:7. And then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. Simply, our Lord God took some dirt and fashioned the very first human being and breathed life into him. Adam, if you think about it, then was one part dirt and one part spirit. And I believe it must have been that connection of dirt to dirt, ashes to ashes, that made it possible for the blind man to connect with Jesus in a way that he received his sight. Because just as God had breathed life into the first man out of dust, with this mud, He restores this man to wholeness. His eyes can see. And I think it's that connection that was made. You, miracles happen when we are united with Christ. There's just something about mud. When Jared was little, he couldn't take him anywhere without jumping in a mud puddle if there was one around. And he would definitely go out of his way. There's just something about mud, isn't there? And you could see by the kid's reaction to that great big mud puddle that there's just something about mud. When water and dirt get mixed together, wonderful things can happen. Jesus takes that dirt and spits into a hand and creates this thing called mud. Now, there's two things that strike me about this. First, to make the mud, Jesus must give of himself. Jesus reaches down and places that dirt in his hand, and then he expresses fluid from himself into that hand. So Jesus gives of himself to mix with the dirt. Just as God had breathed life into the man, Jesus offers himself into the hand to mix with the dirt. It's a very real, that spittle, that moisture from his mouth that's expressed is a very real and visible sign that what is about to happen comes directly from Jesus. So that others will know. When the mud is taken from Jesus' hand and offered to the blind man, sight is miraculously restored. Miracles can happen when we allow ourselves to be dirt and to be mud in Jesus' hand. To be mixed with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, and placed in the hand of one who can make miracles happen. From that hand of Jesus, we can then be used to do awesome and wonderful things to glorify God. To become exactly what it is needed for someone's eyes to be opened and to see Jesus for the very first time. Jesus needs our dirt. Jesus needs our dirt to make holy mud. D, designed to be in partnership with God. Created by God, we have been designed by the Master. Each one of us is unique, aren't we? I praise the Lord that nobody's like me. We're designed by the Master, and each one of us is unique. But each one of us is also made in the image of God. That can be a little confusing. If I'm unique, how can I be made in the image of God? But imago Dei, in the likeness of God. In our first week of Adam Hamilton's Lenten Bible study, the Creed, he helped us investigate what it means to believe in God. What it means that the God is Father Almighty and maker of heaven and earth. First two lines of our Apostles' Creed that we've been using. In the world, in our community today, there's a growing fraction of that hold fast to their convictions that there is no God. That there is no higher power, no higher being. And the adversaries of the religious bodies are becoming more and more vocal and continue to try to disprove God every day. And I believe that there's never been a more important time in history as it is right now to know what it is that we believe about God and why it is we believe. If you are asked today, why do you believe in God? Are you ready to answer? Or would you have to say, I'm not sure? Maybe it was because you started going to church as a kid and you didn't know anything different, and people around you said that there was a God, so you believed it. And that's okay. Maybe it was something else that you came to understand that there is a God. I think some reason why we don't know why we believe in God or what it is exactly that we believe in is because we're afraid to ask questions of God. We're afraid to ask questions that we're thinking about. We don't enter into that conversation so that we can have a firm foundation and a firm understanding of what it is that we believe. And why we believe in God. It's then we can be witness to God's glory. I think as we verbalize our belief, as we question God, as we have that conversation, in that seeking, we will become stronger in our faith. To know more about our God. When things go bad, we already know why we believe in God. When things go good, we know what we believe about God. Many people have asked me since we started this study why we don't do the Apostles' Creed more often or all the time, because many of you remember a time when the Apostles' Creed was a portion of the worship service, right? Many of you had, if you went through confirmation class, had to memorize the Apostles' Creed as part of what you were doing. I have responded to many of that it's about time. There's only so much that I can fit into an hour's worship service, so you have to kind of pick and choose of where you think God and the Holy Spirit's leading you. The other aspect, I have to be very honest with you, is that the Apostles' Creed is something that we all know and we all have memorized. But when we memorize something, what begins to happen? We lose the meaning because we don't have to think about it anymore. You just blurt it out and you go on to the next thing. So that's personally why I don't use it very often, but have brought it back for the Lenten season as we look to see what it is that we believe. Because it's meant to mean something to us. It's a proclamation of our faith. What we believe. The last thing I want to bring forward to you is this image, this idea of being made in God's image. It's a very important one, I believe. Adam led us to reading Exodus 3, 1 to 5, and Acts 17, 16 to 28, and you can check those out. And then these two passages, we find attributes of God. Those things that we say God is. Those attributes. God is creator. God is intelligent. God is communicative. God is loving, patient, kind, moral, and holy. Just to name a few. We have been designed by the Creator to be in the Creator's image. So we are designed to be creative. We are designed to be intelligent beings. We are designed to be communicators, talking with God and each other. We're designed to be loving and patient and moral and holy. And when we are mindful of what we're being designed in the likeness of, and what God means to us, then our lives become transformed. Just like mud transformed this group from a group of individuals to a group that's smiling and interconnected, that changed that whole week for these kids. Just like the mud that Jesus mixed in his hand and placed on that blind man's eyes, Jesus wants us to open our eyes. Be covered in a little mud so that we can see, so that we can enjoy life with Christ. Thank God for mud. Mud can do amazing things. Amen.